I'm conscious, actually, while I'm standing up here, there's probably much more expertise in the audience about the topic that I'm about to talk about than I have. So I'll try and do my best to warm you up with some outrageous thoughts. But I thought I'd begin with one, since we're discussing societies. I mean, the Royal Society is very proud of itself, and it should rightly be, as in, I think, the modern era, one of the great societies. It's worth remembering that its history, in fact, was very practical. Founded in 1660 on the restoration of the monarchy, the king clearly wanted to make sure he was in charge of these unruly academics and could get them to do useful things for him. Quite rapidly, the Royal Society got involved in giving out research grants. One of my favorite ones of these, actually, is to Christian Huygens, the Dutch physicist, who I think was the second foreign member of the Royal Society. But he was funded by the Royal Society to work on clocks, on what we would now call a military research grant. Because at this time, of course, it was already recognized that if you had a good clock, you could figure out where you were just invaded on the planet. And the British Navy was winding up to start doing that kind of thing. Also, I might remark, at this time, I think Britain and Holland were mostly at war, and he was, of course, sitting in Holland taking the money, but never mind. But it's interesting to understand what actually happened to his research. He was trying to build very accurate pendulum clocks, and in order to do so, he constructed them, in fact, in pairs. The reason for constructing two identical clocks in pairs, it was the only way of checking how good they were, because you would build two identical ones, and you would be able to tell if the time they were keeping was slightly different, and that would enable you to judge how well they were working. He discovered something quite remarkable in doing this. He built them actually in a common frame, so they really were identical, and it turned out that they were coupled. And while not normally beating exactly the same time, one day he noticed that if the air was very still in the room, they actually synchronized together. Now, this is an enormous intellectual breakthrough, actually, in science. It's the foundation of much of, we think, the foundation of modern nonlinear dynamics. Actually, it's the basic understanding that goes into lasers and superconductors and whatever. Unfortunately, it was a bit ahead of its time, because when he reported this to the Royal Society, and the paper indeed was read out in front of the assembled multitude, it turns out they weren't very impressed. Basically, the response was, well, you know, we asked you to build accurate clocks, and your clocks are so bad that one clock can influence the time of another one. So it appears that his research grant was not renewed. Actually, they then lost the paper. And it was discovered about a century later in the basement, and finally published around 1780. So I'm not sure whether the society set forward science or backwards at this point, but we'll see. Anyway, I should get moving. I do want to talk about energy and try and warm this topic up so that we can have a bit of a discussion. Until about 200 years ago, we lived moderately sustainably, I think, on the planet, at least by modern terms, because most of the energy came from the sun, and it was usually as food, and work meant physical labor, either of you or of a horse or something else. The Industrial Revolution was powered by fossil fuels, and I think it probably is not an accident that that fossil fuels were that power. But within about a century or so, we will have to change our behavior, and we don't want to return to the age of the horse and cart. So that's really the story. Now, let me tell you what I'm not going to talk about. I'm not going to talk about climate. I'm not going to talk about nuclear. I'm not going to talk about fusion, nor am I going to talk about policy. That's not because they're not important, but I think it's also partly because there are many more experts in the room, and I think you'll hear from them on some of those. What I do want to do is to raise some issues about renewable technologies for generation, for storage, for transmission, and for use. And I think it's worth trying to adopt a posture which puts us a century in the future, assumes that we have solved these problems, and then looks back and figures out how we got there. I don't really know how to do that, but I think it's I'm a theoretical physicist, and it's the kind of thing that theoretical physicists like to imagine. I'm going to suggest right at the start that the goal will actually be that we have electrification as widely as possible, and the reason for that is physics, actually. There is a certain amount of energy coming from the sun, and I will talk about it, but we want to be as efficient and as effective as possible, and so I want to have as fewest set of conversions between the source and the use as possible. And my view of that is turning photons into electrons, moving them around because they're very light, is the right thing to do. So, and I'll point out that, of course, if we did have efficient energy capture from sunlight, and efficient storage, and efficient transmission, and efficient use in lighting and refrigeration in motors and the like, we would be in a very good situation. Can we do it? Now, the second thing I want to talk about, and I'll bring it in now, and I hope it'll fold in into the discussion in a moment, is that energy is money. You know, we often talk about the cost of energy, but actually, again, going back two centuries ago, everything was really priced in terms of its energy input. In medieval times, the standard unit was the cost of a workman's labor. And that was how we thought about that. Now, for a very short period in our history, energy is free. And that has colored the way our society works, it's colored our technologies, and I think that energy is no longer free, and we might begin to think about it as if it was actually a currency. How close are we to that? Well, let me take an example, and the example I have actually is a wind turbine. If you go and buy a wind turbine for about $10 million, you can get an Enercon E126, which is actually a wind turbine with 126-meter wingspan. It's a big object. It is rated at 7.5 megawatts, and it costs 6,000 tons. It weighs 6,000 tons. $10 million, 6,000 tons, that's $1.50 a kilo. It's the right way to think of things like this. And the reason it's quite simple is that actually it's made of stuff. The cost of steel is about $1 a kilo. The cost of aluminum is about $2.50 a kilo. And the cost of both of those is principally the cost of energy that goes into them. It's about third in the case of steel, about half, a little bit more than half for aluminum. So actually, you can figure out, this is known as the hamburger rule, by the way, to economists, that if you want to figure out how much to pay for something, you should weigh it and multiply by the cost of hamburger, and you'll get roughly the right answer, and that works here. But that's, again, because hamburger is also energy. Now, the other thing about this is that you can turn this one round, is that having got one of these things, if you run it at 35% efficiency and sell your electricity about 10 cents per kilowatt hour, it will pay for itself in 3 to 4 years. That's why you see lots of wind turbines. It's very straightforward. And by the way, notice that I could have done that return on investment not by going from dollars to energy to dollars, but just by going from energy to energy, energy in to energy out. Okay? As we approach what I think of as asymptopia, when the price of things converges on the price of the energy cost to go in, those calculations will be much more sensibly done in terms of energy, but it will only work better if we have efficient markets in energy. Otherwise, we deal with currency volatility, which is driven by the fact that actually energy is a rather stable commodity, but valuing it in terms of dollars and pounds and gold bars and things like that is a bit odd. Another way of putting it, actually, is that, you know, as I approach thinking about acquiring a pension, what would I like my pension in? Would I like it to be in treasury bills, or would I like it to be in dollars, or would I like it to be in kilowatt hours? And I think, actually, I'd rather have the latter and be useful. Okay, let me move ahead. So that's energy as money. So now that's the question, is how much energy is there and how much do we use? So the solar input is 345 watts per square meter, averaged over the planet, arriving at the top of the atmosphere, averaging over the years. That's what comes in. That gets converted to heat, to wind, to waves, and to rainfall. And about the only other renewable you have which isn't driven that way is tides. Remember the 345. The US energy use is about 3 terawatts. Conventional units, that's 5 billion microwave ovens. That's also the solar flux on 10,000 square kilometers, which is about the area of Delaware and Rhode Island. Another way of looking at that is to look at the US energy intensity. How much energy does the US use per square meter? It's actually 0.3 watts per square meter on average. Big country, a lot of energy use, but 0.3 turns out to be a relatively low number. That is one part in a thousand of the solar energy which is incident on the United States. It's actually about the same number as India and as China, but for very different reasons, you will understand. Now, it's worth comparing that to some other countries. Let's start with the UK. The UK, the number is 2 watts per square meter. It's about an order of magnitude bigger in energy intensity. If you go to a very densely populated city-state like Singapore, the number is 50. And if you go in the other direction to a country like Brazil, it's 0.03 watts per square meter. Okay. So Singapore is going to be importing energy forever. Brazil actually has relatively low-cost, straightforward solutions from a low-intensity biofuel program. But what you have there is bracketed 4 decades from 0.03 in Brazil to 0.3 in the US to 2 in the UK to 50 in Singapore of the energy intensity. And that means that each of those countries is going to have a different energy policy. Now, sources of energy, where can you get it? Where does it come from? If you want to get solar energy, the best technology is a 19th century one, which is a parabolic mirror and a steam engine. And that will, in good conditions, generate 20 watts per square meter on average. As I say, remember, 345 in, 20 coming out. Current best technologies in solar photovoltaics are a bit lower than that, around 5 to 6. Wind energy is also about the same number. This is, in fact, equipartition, as a physicist would understand. Wind energy is mostly mixed up with thermal energy, too, so there's about the same energy intensity there. Rainfall and dams is around 1 to 2, where it exists. We've used up most of those sites. Wave is negligible in the US, but actually quite important to the country with a long coastline, like the UK, and a small area. And biofuels ranges from good numbers like about 3 or 4 to numbers like -2 for some ethanol programs. In contrast, if you take a nuclear power station, you can get 10 gigawatts on a square kilometer, and that number is 10,000. Right. Message, anyway. If you want to use renewables, they have to be deployed on a country-size scale. Practical applications of these technologies are going to take up something like 5 to 10% of the US land area, and that's the combined area of New Mexico and Arizona, which are bigger states than Delaware and Rhode Island. Now, a separate issue, and about one about which people get confused sometimes, is cost. It's actually possible to make positive return on investment with current technologies. I already mentioned wind, it's going up relatively rapidly. Photovoltaics is different, but at $1 per watt, which is roughly where we're turning back, you get a payback in the same time frame of around 3 or 4 years. And biofuels likewise. I hate biofuels, actually, with current biofuels, but it is possible to make money out of them at the cost of raising the price of food. Interesting problem. The reason that some of these are not appearing enormously is that they don't scale. It's all very well to say that with a stuff which is being dumped on the market by silicon photovoltaic manufacturers, you can actually make a profit. Last year, 2011, yes, solar photovoltaic installation in the US was 10 square kilometers. That sounds like a lot, but it's about the size of Phoenix Airport. As I pointed out, what you needed is something on the scale of 10,000 square kilometers. And despite the fact that doing that would cost you a few trillion dollars, so we could actually afford it. In fact, we could not manufacture the stuff to make that work. So we're in a kind of false market in photovoltaics because for slightly obscure reasons at the moment, it's actually sort of risen to the point where you can make money out of it. But there's no way that it can make a dent with current technologies, and they have to change. And of course, there are substantial interlocking issues associated with the grid, with storage, and with everything else. Now, quickly, I want to be positive. Looking backwards from a century's time, I am absolutely confident that the science problems will have been solved. There's nothing in the way from the laws of thermodynamics. For example, I can imagine a very simple device made from two different materials, very thin, 10 nanometers thick, put together so it has an internal electric field, that's called a ferroelectric, which will absorb the solar spectrum efficiently, will separate the carriers and will store them in situ, and store them at an energy density approaching that of gasoline. I can even give you a set of materials classes of what this might be made of. I don't have a practical demonstration of such a device, but I'm pretty confident that it's possible, but I certainly have no way of manufacturing it cheaply and no way of building it at scale. Why is it difficult? Well, we haven't been trying very long or very hard. Our materials technologies are driven by information technology. The last century, science, and I really say this, is that science, which has been driven by technology, not the other way around, has been driven towards smaller, faster, more expensive, not to things which are large-scale, diverse materials. Sometimes they say you have to engineer them on the nanoscale, and then you have to fabricate them by the ton or by the square kilometer. In fact, we don't have any large-scale materials technologies which conduct electricity other than wires. Metal is about the only thing we have, an ancient technology which we've managed to expand. All of the materials technologies that you see are structural. Okay? It's a science problem. In fact, not an engineering one, because we have to develop new principles of design, new classes of materials. We have to find how they self-organize on a nanoscale, and we have to push them very hard. And while that sounds like it's being driven by technology, I'm absolutely certain that all kinds of unexpected science will come out of those drivers. And, you know, a separate discussion that one could have, but I don't want to go on much longer, is how science disciplines are in fact created in response to technology drivers. How, in fact, the technology driver of building better clocks led somebody to invent the mathematics which now produces superinductors and lasers. Okay. I should comment just briefly on what we're doing at Argonne, because and how it links, in fact, into the rest of science. The most fundamental of our programs is actually to gain better control over materials. We need to be able to engineer them precisely on the atomic scale, to be able to design them so that I know where every atom goes and how it works and how it... Now, for those of you who aren't physicists, you might imagine that since we've had the Schrödinger equation, which controls all of this stuff, for approaching a century, we should know how to do this, but actually we don't. Most of material science is what I call applied serendipity. We discovered stuff, are amazed by it. The science community chases off into some corner and shines bright lights on this bit until some poor postdoc who hasn't discovered what the latest fashion is, digging around in some other part of the field, unearths something else which is important. Okay. We need to get much better than that. But the other thing that you can do is that you can take sweet spots of renewables, and in our case, especially electrical storage, where there are gains that you can make in a short period of time. Electrical storage is an important part of a renewable portfolio because it's necessary for the successful introduction of other technologies. You can't have wind power unless you know what to do when the wind isn't blowing, and you can't have solar power unless you know what's going to happen when the sun goes over by a cloud. There's already a substantial market, actually, in lithium batteries. Everybody in this room is probably carrying around two or three of those. And there is, in fact, a path, a set of industries, and there's really an opportunity there, for example, to drastically reduce the consumption of imported fuel. Final comment on international perspective, and then I'll stop. It's very difficult to do this in a developed country because we have a strong fossil-based energy infrastructure and we have economic actors who are driven by short-term price concerns. It's possible, however, that the most rapid developments might well occur in the developing world because they care more than we do. If you know, an electric car in Chicago is a modest choice based on cost and convenience, but if you're in a village which isn't on the power grid, and somebody will give you a set of linked technologies, and that's solar photovoltaics, electrical storage, efficient refrigeration and lighting, that means an enormous change. It means you have food storage, so you don't need to walk to the market every day. It means you have vaccinations and healthcare, and it means you have education. And in fact, that's really the sets of things that we need to focus on, because those are the ones that will actually change the world. So I think what that also means, of course, is that the economic transformation, because I'm confident that we will have it, is going to derive a geographical and a social one. And I think the ramifications of that are, in fact, very difficult to understand. But as it's done in the past, it'll do it in the future. And we need to pay as much attention to the hidden benefits of what we're trying to do as to the obvious ones. And there I should stop, hoping to have warmed you up. Thank you very much.